All right, let's now talk about gradients, the derivative of multivariable functions. So here we are now interested in functions that have multiple inputs. So note though that the term multivariable and multivariate are sometimes used interchangeably. So multivariate is usually a more common term, but here we really mean multivariable because multivariate can mean multiple outputs. Here we are currently only focusing on a case where we have multiple inputs and a single output. So for example, if you consider linear regression, you can have multiple inputs like the features of your data set. So if you have a training example with multiple features, or think of the iris data set where you have sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width, there would be multiple inputs, but the output, there would be only one output, for example, a continuous value like for regression or a class label for the prediction. In this case, we are focusing now on the multivariable functions. So consider a function where we have multiple inputs. If we only had one input, we would usually write the derivative as follows with a smaller letter d here. Now, since we have multiple variables, we have actually a vector as the derivative. This is also the so-called gradient. We use this upside down triangle, the nabla here. So this is, I think it's spelled like this, nabla. So here we have multiple things going on now in this vector. So each row is a partial derivative. So what is a partial derivative? It's essentially like the full derivative. However, it's for a function where we have multiple input arguments. And if we compute the partial derivative of f with respect to x, what we do is we set y and z here, or if we have multiple ones, we set all of these as constants. So we treat them as regular numbers, not as variables, while we compute this one. And then once we have computed this partial derivative, we then focus on the second entry, the partial derivative of f with respect to y, while considering x and z as constants and so forth. So we compute each derivative one at a time. The rules are the same as for the full derivative. So really the big difference here is only that we treat the other variables as constants. But yeah, that is essentially a very similar concept. So here's an example to illustrate that. So consider this function here, x squared y plus y. So that two inputs, x and y, for this function here. So when we then compute the gradient of this function, we have two partial derivatives. The partial derivative of x with respect to the partial derivative of f with respect to x, and the partial derivative of f with respect to y. So we can compute them separately. We don't have to intermix them. We can do one at a time. So let's start with the partial derivative. Let me use the same color maybe. Partial derivative of f with respect to x. So what we do is we treat y as a constant, so you can think of it as a regular number. So it's essentially like computing x times 1 plus 1, something like that. So, and if you think of the power rule, what happens is the 2 goes up front and then minus 1, so it will be just 2x, and this one will stay, right? So if this was a 2 or something, this would stay. So here also the y stays, so we have 2xy, and then plus the derivative of a constant is 0, so plus 0, so the derivative would be 2xy for this one, so using the power rule and the constant rule. Now we have computed this partial derivative, 2xy. Now we can compute the partial derivative for the second entry, for the partial derivative for f with respect to y. So that's what I have down here. Notice instead of x, we are focusing now on y. So x here, x is now a constant. And if this basically then stays, right? So we have then just 2x squared as the constant. So it's like if you consider a case where we have something like 2x and we compute, so f of x, we compute the derivative of df with respect to x. So this would be 2, right? So in the same way, if this is a constant, the y goes away, it just stays. And the 1 is also a constant. Oh, sorry. The y here is the variable. So the derivative of just the variable is 1, right? So then the derivative of the whole part would be x squared plus 1. All right, so we have both. And then we just arrange them in the vector here. And this is our gradient. Okay, now let's consider the case where we have a composite function like the following one. Notice that we have two inputs. So we have g and h, two inputs here, but they both rely on the same input argument here. So there's an inner x that is shared by both functions here. So remember from the regular chain rule that I explained in the last video, if we have a function nesting like this one and we want to compute the derivative, we can do this by computing the derivative of the outer part times the derivative of the inner part. Now for the two inputs, we have the following case. They have a dependency, they depend both on x. So it's a little bit trickier. So we actually combine them because we have this dependency here. So we still use the chain rule here, but we combine the results. So if we want to compute the derivative of this function with respect to x, the inner argument. So note that we are not computing partial derivative of g of f with respect to g and for example h separately as the gradient, because both really depend on x. I mean, we do this and this as part of it, but it's not the end result compared to the previous slide where we had a gradient where we had different input arguments. So here, like I just said, we have these partial terms with respect to g. So let me use different colors for this part. This is one part and this is the other part. However, both share the same x. So the derivative of this function with respect to x, the one argument. So in fact, we have one argument in a way here. We combine them here with, where's my yellow, with this plus symbol here. So let me clear this. It's maybe more clear like that. We still use the chain rule. Let's maybe focus on this part. For this part, we still use the chain rule like here. So we have an inner and an outer part. So the outer part is a partial derivative, f with respect to g. Here we use the partial symbol because there's g and h. However, there's only one input argument to g, so here we use the little d. If you don't do this like consistently like that, I think no one would blame you. If we just use partial symbols, it would be fine too. But yeah, this would be the proper way. So this would be the derivative for this part. And then for the second part, we have the partial derivative of f with respect to h, so, and then the inner part. So let me do this one more time. So this is one part, this is the other part, and here we have the chain rule for each of them, the outer one and the inner one. Here we also have the outer one and the inner one. All right. Let's take a look at an example to apply this in practice. Yeah, consider the following function where we have two input functions, g and h. So this is just for reference what I had on the previous slide. And the function is g squared h plus h, where g is also a function that takes as input x, where this is 3x, so the function g is 3x. And then h also is a function taking input x, and so this function is x squared. All right, so doing it one at a time. So let's focus on this part first, which is here. So here, this is the partial derivative of x with respect to g. So if we take a look at this and differentiate it with respect to g, use the power rule, so this goes up front and goes away, and this is a constant because it's a partial derivative. H is a constant, so this also goes away. So what the result is 2gh. So now let's take a look at the inner part, so the inner part of g. So let me use this color. So g is 3x, so we are looking at this one now. So the derivative of 3x is just 3, right? So if we derive g with respect to its only input, so there is only one input, then we don't have to treat anything as a constant because there is nothing else except x, and the derivative of that is 3. Now let's take a look. So we solved basically this in this part. Now let's take a look at the other part here, the partial derivative of f with respect to h, the other argument. So if we treat, so if we compute partial derivative of f with respect to h, then we treat everything that is not h as a constant. So this is a constant. So in this way, if g squared is a constant, then the derivative of this part with respect to h would be g squared, right? So we have g squared, and this is then 1, right? The derivative of a variable is just 1. All right, so g squared plus 1. Do I have it somewhere here? Right, so here we have it. And then the last part, the derivative of h with its with respect to its input x. So which color do we have left here? This one maybe. So let's compute this term now, the derivative of h with respect to x. And h is x squared, so the derivative should be 2x using the power rule. So that's 2x. And now we just bring everything together. So we have the first part and the second part. So I don't have any colors left that I haven't used yet. So let me just use black for this left part here. We bring those together. So this is basically this part. And then for the right part here, we bring those together, and this is this part. And then if we just simplify this, so if you take a look at this and you expand these terms, it simplifies as follows. So this would be how we use the multivariable chain rule. Yeah, I don't want to go overboard, but we can also go one step further and write this more compactly using vector notation. So again, the same function here, f with two input functions, g and h, which in turn take both x as input. So if we compute the derivative, this is what we have written down before. And we can also write this more compactly using vector notation. So I'm writing it as gradient of f with respect to its inputs, and then times the derivative of a vector v. So the vector v, we define it as a vector containing those two inputs here. And then the derivative would be, the derivative of this vector would be containing both the derivative of g with respect to x and the derivative of d with respect, of h with respect to x. So this is more like a compact form of writing down these partial terms. So basically this term and this term. Sorry, not the partial terms, but the inner terms. So these are the inner derivatives. And now then putting it together, so where this comes from, I mean, if you then consider the gradient of the function with respect to its inputs, so that's the gradient we discussed. So the partial terms, and then here the inner terms. And if you look at it now, so if you use or compute the dot product, right? So in order to compute the dot product, what we have is, let me use this color, this times this plus this times this, right? So this is how we usually compute the dot product. So it expands to this one. So it's just like a little convenience thing to write things more compactly. Yeah, there's one more concept to cover, the Jacobian matrix. So consider now a case where f is a vector. So you have a vector f f is a function, and there could be multiple inputs. So let's consider the expanded form here. So this vector, so there's f1, f2, f3, fm, different functions. Each of them has the inputs x1, x2, x3, xm. So this could be, for example, a case perceptron, where you have a net input function and it takes multiple features as input. So the Jacobian of this this vector here is written down here. So the Jacobian is a matrix where all the combinations are considered. So the partial derivative of f1 with respect to x1, the partial derivative of f1 with x2 with respect to x2, the partial derivative of f2 with respect to x1, and so forth. Yeah, so you can see all the different combinations here. All right. I see I have highlighted one thing. To highlight, this is the gradient of function 1, for example, with respect to its inputs, if you recall the gradient that we discussed earlier. So each row of these of this Jacobian matrix would be basically a gradient of a function or a function gradient. So second order derivatives. So let's talk about second order derivatives. No, I'm just kidding. So we won't be talking about second order derivatives because we won't be needing it for this class. Actually, second order derivatives can be useful. Some people have done some research working with them in deep learning, but so far it has not been very fruitful. There are proof of concepts that it conceptually works, but it is very slow and there's not really any advantage over using first order methods. So despite some research efforts, as far as I know, no one is really seriously using second order gradient methods yet. At the point when I'm recording this, maybe in the future there will be a method that is vastly superior compared to our current methods, but so far it has not been done very prominently, or very, I wouldn't say successfully, because the research in itself was successful, but it's not very practical, I would say. All right, so with that, let's not worry about second order methods then. Let's go back to the more exciting parts, to the machine learning and deep learning parts. So in the next two videos, I will be wrapping up this lecture on gradient descent and then training a single layer neural network.